Good afternoon. Welcome to God's house. So over the next several weeks, we're going to be in a new series. We're starting a series today called Tell Us a Story. Because much of what Jesus has to tell us is in the form of stories, in the form of parables. And a parable is just another word for kind of a simple story that conveys some sort of timeless, eternal, spiritual truth. And so, in particular today, the profound truth that Jesus teaches us through a story is this, that we need to stop thinking of God as though he thinks like us. We need to stop expecting God to be fair with us. Because while God is perfectly just, God is not fair with us. He's merciful. Unbelievably merciful. So that's what we're focusing on today. A story of perplexing mercy and generosity. And our worship begins with our first hymn, Magnificent, Marvelous, Matchless Love. It's probably a new hymn for you. We will play it through the projection system. Feel free to sing along or just listen to the words as you wish.
Too vast and astounding to tell, forever existing in worlds above, now offered and given to all. Oh, fountain of beauty eternal, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, sufficient and endlessly generous, magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. Every shadow.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment, both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, you call us to work in your kingdom and promise to reward us according to your grace. Help us to rid our minds of worldly expectations and rejoice that you freely pour out the blessings of salvation to all people through the merits of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading from God's Word today is from Jonah chapter 3, as you see. And here the Lord gives his reluctant prophet a profound lesson in both natural human hypocrisy and also his own merciful generosity. In other words, as you'll hear in the sermon, he doesn't think like us. His ways are not like our ways, but they are way, way, way better. We read beginning at verse 10 of Jonah chapter 3. When God saw their actions, meaning the actions of the Ninevites, that they had turned from their evil way, God relented from the disaster which he said he would bring upon them, and he did not carry it out. But to Jonah, this all seemed very bad, and he became very angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Lord, wasn't this exactly what I said when I was still in my own country? That is why I previously fled to Tarshish, because I knew that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abounding in mercy, and you relent from sending disaster. So now, Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Is it right for you to be angry? Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city. He made a shelter for himself there and sat in the shade under it, waiting to see what would happen in the city. Then the Lord God provided a plant and made it grow up over Jonah to provide shade over his head, to relieve him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm, and it attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind. The sun beat down on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die. So he said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" Jonah said, "I do have a right to be angry. Angry enough to die." So the Lord said, "You have been concerned about this plant. You did not work for it or make it grow. It grew up in one night and perished after one night. So should I not be concerned for Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know the difference between their right hand and their left, and also many animals?" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm of the day is Psalm 115, which reminds us that the Lord God is real, the only God, and that the only God is truthful and merciful and generous to all people, regardless of status. We read it responsively. "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory. Because of your mercy, because of your truth. Why should the nations say, 'So where is their God now?' In fact, our God is in the heavens. He does everything that pleases him. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of human hands. Israel, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord remembers us. He will bless. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless those who fear the Lord, the small with the great." Our second scripture lesson is from Romans chapter 9, where we hear God's apostle explain one aspect of the breathtaking generosity of God, which is his predestination of the elect, how God, before the creation of the world, mercifully chose to save us. Now, as you listen to this, this second lesson today, please realize that Paul is using a Hebrew idiom when he says that God loved Jacob but hated Esau. That is not meant to imply, as some have wrongly understood it, to mean that God therefore predestines some people to be saved and he predestines other people to be condemned. Because the Bible is very clear in other places that God loves the world, that God our Savior wants all people to be saved. The Hebrew idiom for loving something and hating something doesn't imply what it sounds like to our human ears. There's just not a perfect way of translating it. Instead, loving one thing and hating another is a Hebrew idiom to imply that one thing is given some sort of special treatment. It doesn't really mean that God hates the other thing. It just means that one thing gets preferential treatment. So that's really important to realize. And so the point Paul is making is that God mercifully chose to save some people because he was giving them special treatment, because he is merciful, because he is gracious. So, that explanation said, let me read from Romans chapter 9, and we're going to begin reading at verse 6. Chapter 9, verse 6. All right, "It is not as though God's word had failed, for not all who are descended from Israel are Israel. Nor, because they are his descendants, are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. In other words, it is not the natural children who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who are regarded as Abraham's offspring. For this is what the promise said: I will arrive at this set time, and Sarah will have a son. Not only that, but Rebekah also had children by one man, our forefather Isaac. Even before the twins were born, or did anything, good or bad, in order that God's purpose in election might continue, not by works, but because of him who calls us, it was said to her, the older will serve the younger, just as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. What will we say then? Does this mean that God is unjust? Absolutely not. For God says to Moses, I will show mercy to whom I show mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then, and again, this is the point he's trying to make, it does not depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. Alleluia, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God. Alleluia. The gospel is from Matthew chapter 20, where Jesus tells a story to highlight the foolishly exacting nature of humanity as opposed to the overwhelming generosity of God. We read, indeed, the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. After agreeing to pay the workers a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. He also went out about the third hour and saw others standing unemployed in the marketplace. To these he said, you also go into the vineyard, and I will give you whatever is right. So they went. Again he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did the same thing. When he went out about the 11th hour, he found others standing unemployed. He said to them, why have you stood here all day unemployed? They said to him, because no one hired us. He told them, you also go into the vineyard. When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the workers and pay them their wages, starting with the last group and ending with the first. When those who were hired around the 11th hour came, they each received a denarius. When those who were hired first came, they thought they would receive more. But they each received a denarius too. After they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. Those who were last worked 1 hour, and you made them equal to us who have endured the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he answered one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not make an agreement with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go. I want to give to the last one hired the same as I also gave to you. Can't I do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? In the same way, the last will be first, and the first last. The gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. You may be seated. For our next hymn, our soloist will sing the first verse so you can hear how it goes, and then you're invited to join in singing verses 2 through 4.
Not what my hands have done can save my guilty soul, not what my toiling flesh has borne can make my spirit whole. Not what I fear or do can give me peace with God. Not all my prayers and sighs and tears can bear my awful load. I work alone, O Christ, can ease this weight of sin. Thy blood alone, O Lamb of God, can give me peace within. Thy love to me, O God, not mine, O Lord, to thee, can rid me of this dark unrest and set my spirit free. I bless the Christ of God. I rest on love divine, and with unfaltering lip and heart, I call this Savior mine. His cross dispels each doubt. I bury in his tomb each thought of unbelief and fear, each lingering shade of gloom. I praise the God of grace. I trust his truth and might. He calls me his and call him mine. My God, my joy, my light. My Lord has saved my life and freely pardon gives. I love because he first loved me. I live because he lives.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, when I was a child, my mother had a picture on the wall of the bathroom. And though I was going to describe that picture to you, the wonders of modern technology means that I can actually show you a little glimpse into my childhood bathroom, which is exactly what I know you came here wanting to see. So here it is. This was the picture. Thanks, Tom. The picture that was there. So this is cute, right? Except the reason I'm showing you this is not because I wanted to, you know, show you something cute, but I showed you that because that picture actually tells us something profound about human nature. I'm not making a potty joke here. What I mean is that last line where it said how long a minute is depends upon which side of the door you're on, that line alludes to the reality that though everybody has an innate desire for fairness and justice, our perception of what is fair and what is just is not exactly always on point. Right? How long a minute is really does, if you're not looking directly at a clock, it depends on what side of the door you're on. Or to give you another example, when you are the one who is watching a game, you can get pretty incensed at the referees when they blow a call. Except if you've ever worn the stripes yourself, well, then that's when people ought to grow up, right? And realize that it's just a game and these are just kids, and right? Or on a deeper level, when somebody has wronged you, overlooking the fault does not come very naturally. We want apologies. We want full apologies. We want a clear articulation of what they did and that it will never happen again. And we might well want that person who wronged us to kind of, at least in some way, get a sense of the pain that we endured. Maybe a little dose of their own medicine so that they realize exactly what they did so that it doesn't happen again. But if the shoe is ever on the other foot, right, when you were the one who did the thing that somebody else got incensed about or that somebody else is saying hurt them, well, that's when, again, people should lighten up a little bit. That's when people should realize that nobody's perfect. That's when people should just learn how to forgive, like Jesus tells all of us to forgive, right? So when we're the ones in the crosshairs of justice, when we're the one from whom it's being demanded, justice is not quite as important as it was when we're demanding it of somebody else. And that's why the word of the Lord that I have to share with you today from Isaiah chapter 55 is such a marvelous thing. You can see it on the screen and here. The Lord says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the evil man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him. And to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." So you see, almost always, when you hear those words of Scripture quoted, and we hear them quoted all the time, it's in some sort of a difficult time. It's in some sort of tragedy. And, of course, there's not a problem with that. The principle of God's thoughts not being our thoughts, his ways not being our ways, it applies in times of tragedy. When your spouse gets terminal cancer, or when you suddenly lose a child, or when you suffer with some sort of a thorn in your flesh that torments you day after day, it is good to remember that you do not and you cannot see things from God's perspective. That we have no clue what he was sparing our loved one from by taking them to heaven a little earlier than what might be considered normal. That we can't understand how much we need that thorn in our flesh to keep us from wandering away from the only one who can save us. In tough times, it's good to remember that, yes, God's thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. They're higher, they're better. That said, though, that is not the context of the verse when it's first stated. The context in which God originally speaks these words is not a context of tragedy. In the original context of the verse, God is not saying that people have this really hard time with the way he runs the universe, as much as he is saying that people have a really hard time with the way he runs his courtroom, the way he runs heaven. So again, to go back to the whole when somebody wrongs us scenario, when somebody wrongs you, you want justice. That doesn't mean you always demand physical punishment, but it does mean what I said before. You want them to understand it, you want them to be sorry for it, and you want them to take steps to make sure that in whatever way they need to, it doesn't happen again. But when we wrong God, as we do day in and day out, this is not what he expects from us. Yes, he wants us to repent. Of course he does, because sin destroys, and he wants us to turn from sin. But God knows that you don't actually have a clue how horrible your sin really is. And you don't have a clue how much your sin hurt him or hurts the people around you. And he knows that your sorrow over your sins is never going to match the depth of his. And he knows that even though you can promise that you are never going to do that again, you may well not finish the day or even the prayer itself without starting to go back to that sin in your mind. Yet because his ways are inconceivably higher than ours, God does not demand justice from you. Because he already demanded it long ago from himself in the person of Jesus Christ. God is just. And he sent Jesus so that he could be both just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Christ. This is why just two chapters prior, the Lord himself spoke through his prophet in Isaiah, in the book of Isaiah, and said, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed." So now, no matter what the sin is, no matter how much the sin is, no matter how many they are, when you turn to God in repentance, the only thing that is left for you is an abundance, a boatload of pardon and peace and everything good. The Hebrew of Isaiah chapter 55 literally says, "Let the wicked turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." This is good news. When you come to God for forgiveness, you don't get what you sadly give or get from your spouse or your children. You don't get God questioning, "Are you really sorry?" You don't get him asking, do you really get what you did? You don't get any sort of probationary period in which you have to kind of earn his trust again and make up for what you did. You don't get him demanding anything from you. No matter how pathetic, no matter how guilty, no matter how wretched you are, when you turn to God, you get the inconceivable. You get God in the flesh standing here in this world, smiling at you and saying, "I didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but to save it." You get God smiling down from you, on you from heaven, saying, "Take heart, son. Your sins are forgiven." You get the father in the story of the prodigal son who sprints towards you, shouting to start the party, shouting that the ring be brought and put on your finger and sandals on your feet. You get God fully restoring you to the blessed status of his son, his daughter, his heir, which means an heir of all things. And you get it all because the only God who is a God whose thoughts are not like ours, whose ways are not like ours. We get it all because we have a God who is not just fair, but is inconceivably better. Praise be to God, huh? Amen. Please stand. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses mere human knowledge, guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's join together now in speaking the words of the Apostles' Creed as we confess our faith in God and His goodness. It's on page 11. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And if you haven't yet, please take just a minute to fill out one of the care cards, and then you can leave that in the offering plate right outside the sanctuary on your way out of the church. And then we'll join together to speak the responsive prayer of thanksgiving. We join to pray. Lord of heaven and earth, You made all things beautiful. You've provided green forests and refreshing streams. You've arranged the orderly procession of day and night for our work and rest. Thank You for the mountains and the prairies, the roaring sea and the gentle breeze. Thank You for roofs that shelter us, for clothing that protects us, and for food and drink. Thank You for our work, for projects that are done well, and for the approval of supervisors and teachers. Thank You for all who serve at night to make our days more pleasant. Thank You for associates at work, for their encouragement and praise, and for the joys of human friendships. Thank You for our cities and our countrysides, for farms and factories, for streets and highways, and for all of life that flows so swiftly before us. Thank You for children at play, their boundless energy, and their shouts of joy and laughter. Thank You for the morning greetings we receive, and for all the smiles that come from faces loved by You. Thank You for Christian parents, for their affection and their care. Thank You for bringing healing when we are sick, for the protection You send when we are in danger, and the comfort You offer when we are sad. Hear our prayers especially today for the family of Christina Justice as they continue to mourn her loss here on earth. Lead us all to be thankful as we believe that in all things You do work for the good of those who love You. Thank You for those who help and encourage us in difficult times. Finally, Lord, thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ, for His coming to redeem us, for His coming to us in word and sacraments, for His continual giving and forgiving, and for listening to our prayers. Receive our gifts and offerings as our sacrifice of praise. Lead us in thankful living today and always. Amen. Because of Your mercy, we are also bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We join now to sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
Please stand. Blessed Lord, you've given us the Holy Scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated as we join to sing our final two verses. Again, in the name of Jesus, good afternoon. Good to have you all here today. You are increasing our Wednesday worship attendance lately. I mean, I love Sunday, but it's nice to have more than like three people here on Wednesdays too. So good to have you here. It's encouraging. So I wanted to highlight a couple of things before you went home today. First of all, as you probably heard, Pastor Mike Duncan has accepted our call to serve as a part-time pastor here, primarily as a visitation pastor and then preaching every other week. He's going to be installed as our pastor this coming Sunday morning at 8 a.m. And so if you want to come back to church, you know, if that was worth seeing that bathroom sign again. And he'll be installed this coming Sunday. So maybe the next time you see him, just welcome him in the Lord. I also wanted to highlight that this coming weekend is our Everyone Outreach event. So that begins 8 a.m. on Saturday morning to 1 p.m. Then again, it's after church, starting at 9:30 a.m. on Sunday and going until 12:30 p.m. And yes, we will at 12:30, put on the Packer game in there while we have some pizza. So I also wanted to highlight for you that the ladies' Bible study time is changing. It is moving 30 minutes earlier to 6 p.m. starting this week, Tuesday. So ladies' Bible study moving earlier in the evening to 6 p.m. And then the last thing I wanted to highlight again is that we're doing our yearly Lutheran Women's Missionary Society offering. I guess that we have two a year, and that is, as you exit the sanctuary, if you'd like to support their work, you can read more about it there. And, of course, I believe there was a box out there. I think there is still a box out there that you can, there's still a box, so you can support their work that way as well, or just with your prayers. That's all I have. Hope you have a great rest of your day in the Lord and enjoy the beautiful weather God's given us.